Hello friends, I am Rishmi. Welcome to SRS Info. Today we are going to start the second chapter of pharmaceutical chemistry, that is common inorganic pharmaceutical compounds. Today we will give an introduction about this. This is about the common inorganic pharmaceutical compounds. Both organic and inorganic compounds are used in pharmaceutical industry. Okay. And in this chapter, we will cover the main inorganic compounds which are used in this pharmaceutical industry. So let's start. The inorganic pharmaceutical compounds which are used in this pharmaceutical industry are mainly classified into 9 categories. These are acids, base and buffer, antioxidants, gastrointestinal agents, then topical agents, dental products, inhalants, respiratory stimulants, expectorants and emetics, and antidotes. These are the broad division of the inorganic pharmaceutical compounds. All these main topics have enough subtopics. We will discuss a number of compounds under these categories. Okay, this is a long chapter. We will divide it into many subtopics. Okay, today I will give just an introduction about acids, bases, and buffers. So, acids, bases, and buffers display an important role in pharmaceutical chemistry. We all know about it very well. And these acids, bases, and buffers required in the manufacture and also in the quality assurance of drugs. In the quality assurance, acids and bases play very important role. We need these acids and bases to do the quality assay work. And again, these are used as pharmaceutical aids and necessities in dispensing the pharmaceuticals for their stability, compatibility, and optimum distribution in various physiological systems. What do you mean by optimum distribution? Suppose this is tablet. Tablet is made by granules. Granules contains the medicaments, the actual medicaments. Okay. Granules are undergoing compression. After that, the tablet will produce. If these granules are not uniformly distributed in this tablet, then it will not pass the quality assay test. And again, if this drug or the medicament is not properly or uniformly distributed in this tablet, it will adversely affect the patient also. So, uniform distribution of the medicaments in all parts of that particular administrative dosage form, whether it is tablet, injection, syrup, gel, ointment, whatever it is, the uniformity of the distribution of the medicament is very important. And this uniform distribution, which is known as optimum distribution, is done with the help of this aids, that is acids, bases, and buffers. So, now you're clear about the importance of acids and bases in this pharmaceutical industry. Now, there are various concepts about what is an acid and what is a base. Nowadays, there are enough theories and enough concepts are emerging day by day. But one thing is that all these new theories and concepts are the extensions of the first and classical concept of acids and bases. What is it? It is Arrhenius' concept of acids and bases. In this chapter, we will discuss some more concepts also. Today, I will cover only this Arrhenius' concept. Mr. Arrhenius in 1887 defined about the first concept, which is also known as the classical concept of the definition of acids and bases, are put forward by Mr. Arrhenius in 1887. According to his concept, what is an acid? Let's see. According to this theory, acids are the substances which are capable of providing hydrogen ions when dissolved in water. Okay. And bases are those substances which contain hydroxy groups or capable of providing hydroxy ions in aqueous solution. Note the point, aqueous solution. He defined the concept of acid and bases on the basis of its properties in aqueous solution. Okay. And in aqueous solution, what do acid do? Acid will release H plus. Acid will release hydrogen ions, which is positive in nature. And the base will release hydroxyl ions, which is negative in nature. So, those substances which release hydroxyl groups or negative ions in the aqueous solution is known as base. And those substances which release H plus, that is positive ions or protons in aqueous solution is known as acid. This was his concept. And he also explained about the neutralization reaction. What do you mean by neutralization reaction? Suppose this is an acid and this is a base. What will happen if both the acid and base comes together? It will react. This reaction is known as neutralization reaction. Why? Because it gives a salt plus water. For example, suppose we mix hydrochloric acid with the sodium hydroxide. Okay, this is an acid and this is a base. What will happen? This come here, NaCl, that is sodium chloride, and this will meet form H2O, that is water. NaCl is a salt. That is, he said, that is acid plus base give salt and water. This was his concept about the neutralization reaction of acids and bases. Okay. And he also said that the properties of an acid in an aqueous solution is based on the release or the capacity to release the hydrogen ions. In the same way, the properties of bases in an aqueous solution is based on its capacity to release the hydroxyl ions, that is negative. And based on this degree of ionization, that is how much it is capable to release these hydrogen ions or these hydroxyl ions, he again classified these acids into strong and weak acids and the bases into strong and weak bases respectively. The high degree of ionization remarks the characteristics of strong acids and strong bases, and small degree of ionization explains about the characteristics of weak acids and weak bases. This is about Arrhenius' concept. I hope you clear about the concept explained by Arrhenius about acids and bases. Okay. Even though it explained in detail about the characteristics of acids and bases, this concept also has some limitations. What are the limitations? The first point is that he explained very well about the properties of acids and bases in aqueous solution, but he could not explain the characteristics of the substances which do not have this H plus or OH group. That means those substances which have this acidic property, which do not have this H plus ions, he could not explain. And he could not explain the basic nature of those substances which do not have this hydroxyl groups. That's written here. It could not explain the basic nature of substances which do not contain OH minus ions. For example, Na2CO3 and ammonia. Ammonia has basic characteristics, but he could not explain it. Why he could not explain? Because it does not have this OH minus, and the acidic nature of those substances which do not contain H plus ions, like carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide has an acidic property. Carbon dioxide has an acidic property, but he could not explain it. Why? Because it does not contain H plus ions. This was the first limitation. And the second argument against this Arrhenius concept is it is limited only to aqueous media, okay, and it does not lend itself to the extension to the non-aqueous system. It could not explain anything about the properties of acids and bases in non-aqueous system. This was the two arguments against this Arrhenius concept. Both the advantages of this concept and the disadvantages, both are very important in your exam point of view. So today I just started the topic. In the coming classes, we will discuss in detail about the other concepts of acids and bases, and we will start into the topic of the products of acids, bases and buffers, which are used in the pharmaceutical industry. Hope you enjoy this video. Thank you.